Thanks for tuning in to this week's classic episode of Angler West. This week we're going to beautiful Montana to do some fly fishing for trout on the lower Madison River. Spectacular place to fish. Now if you've never tried fly fishing, I would suggest that you do so. I really enjoy fly fishing myself. In fact, it was the first type of fishing that I ever learned how to do. And I was taught by my Uncle Hugh, who is one of the people fishing in today's episode. Fly fishing's great. It's just that it's gotten a little controversial over the years and things have changed. And it's crazy to me. You know, when I was early on fishing a lot, you know, when I was a teenager and so forth, I always had a fly rod, a spinning rod, and a bait casting rod with me, and I would use whatever would make the most sense. And then things changed. Like, I think it was that movie, River Runs Through It. I don't know. Right about then, all of a sudden, fly fishing became this whole different thing, and I didn't understand it, and everybody had to wear certain clothes, and it was just crazy. Fly fishing is just a technique, and it can be extremely effective. There's certain species of fish, certain times of the year, where a good fly fisherman will outfish anyone else, and that's just the way it is. And it's a lot of fun. Now, I've never had much fly fishing tackle in the shop here, but that's about to change. Every day, just seems like Carissa, my sales manager, says, "Oh, you need to get some fly fishing stuff in here," because every day people are coming in and asking for it. Seems like it's getting more popular. And just like fishing is getting more popular, a lot more people fishing, and that's great. So we're gonna have some really good fly tackle in here pretty quick. And I highly suggest if you've never tried fly fishing, give it a shot. Now, let's go to Montana, one of the most beautiful places you can do some fly fishing, and check out the lower Madison River.
All right. Today, we're fly fishing the lower Madison River near Bozeman, Montana, as the guest of my Uncle Hugh Huntley, who's fishing with guide Peter Bakun of Gallatin River Guides.
Oh, no.
It's the middle of winter, so we have our long underwear on as well as some small wintertime fly patterns.
We're going to use a small strike indicator, and what I'm doing is just bending, putting a loop in the leader.
Yeah.
And then I stick the stick that through my strike indicator, and then when I have that loop, I'm going to just pull the flies.
Oh, you pull the whole fly
back through,
back
through that loop, and now, right now, the water we're going to be fishing in, this strike indicator is about twice the distance to the bottom of the river.
All right.
And if we want to change and make it. Put the strike indicator up higher because we're in deeper water we can, or if we go into shallower water, all I have to do is push on that loop and move the strike indicator down.
Okay.
And for this time of year, we're starting with a small pink scud, a brass bead right in the middle of it, of that pink scud, and that helps to get it down. And then we can use either a midge pupa or something like that. So let's take a look, and I think we'll start out with a red midge pupa right here, and we'll tie that on and you'll be ready to go fishing.
All right. And what size is that now?
That's a size 18.
18.
Where we're fishing is called the Lower Madison. It's below Bear Trap Canyon. We're about probably 75 miles from Yellowstone Park, and we're about 30 miles from downtown Bozeman, Montana. This section of the river fishes really well most of the winter and spring and early summer, and then because of Ennis Lake it gets a little warm in the summer and then it turns on again in September. Mainly brown trout and rainbow trout, and an occasional, when we get near the feeder streams, there might be a brook trout, but it's mainly a rainbow and brown trout fishery. It's a fun place to be in the winter because there's only about 10 or 12 people here on a weekday in about 15, 20 miles of river. The reason I'm using two strike indicators is actually in some ways I was just too lazy to take one off, but later on in the afternoon I'll use a little bit bigger stonefly nymph or something like that, and this small indicator that we're using won't stay above the water, and with two, if one goes under, then I can still see the other one. Today, as you can see, I chose to walk and wade, which I do almost all the time in January, February, and March, because this section of the river, number one, has really nice road access on both sides of it, And number two, once you get in that drift boat, you're committed to 5 or 6 hours on the river. And I've been over here when all of a sudden a storm blows in or the wind starts coming down that Bear Trap Canyon at 40 miles an hour and snowing sideways. It's really nice to be able to get in the car, turn that heater on, and relax for a bit, maybe eat a sandwich, and then if it passes, keep fishing. If it doesn't, you can go home or do whatever. That's a typical Madison River rainbow. Nice chunky fish. Even in the middle of winter, they eat well in here, and as you can see, he's got good. He's not skinny. All right, let him. See you later. All right, that was fun. He ate that pink scud right there, and. You know, I've been told that there aren't any scuds in the Madison River, so they might be taking it for a cluster of eggs, either brown trout or whitefish eggs or something like that, or maybe just the nice pink color.
Welcome back to the Lower Madison River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're in the middle of the fly fishing paradise known as Montana. And remnants of the last snowfall mark our trail to the icy cold water of the Madison, which is full of feeding trout that will only get more active as the water warms throughout the day.
I don't know if you noticed, Hugh, but we've got some of those little ice discs. They look like little frisbees floating down.
I see.
And
I see
when they get in right now, they've come down. And did you notice they got into this ripple and they were breaking up?
Yeah.
So there must be a little bit of warmth coming. And hopefully by the time, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock comes, we should start catching a few more fish. There we go. Little one. He's on the scud. Ooh. You know, I told you browns and rainbows, but this might be a cutbow. We'll have to see. Oh, it's a little brown, silvery colored brown trout. At this time of year, we're catching about 25% browns and about 75% rainbows on a bright sunny day. On an overcast day, it's just the opposite. It'll be about 70, 75% browns and 25% rainbows. And then it also depends where you are. Sometimes you'll get into a pod of fish and it'll be almost all browns, and then another spot you'll get in and it'll be all rainbows, or and it's really just dependent on where you are. There he goes. But we've had, today we'll probably end up with more rainbows than browns because of the bright sun. Of course, as soon as I say that, guess what's gonna happen? We'll have a lot more browns. Another little one on he's on the scud. I could see him hit the pink scud. Here in the Madison, they stopped stocking this. I think it was in the late 60s or early 70s, and these are all wild fish. They're all, now they're not real natives because the cutthroat is a native, but the rainbows and browns are wild fish that spawn in the river. And some days it seems like you're catching a lot of small fish and maybe just a couple of big ones. And yesterday we had some really nice clouds come in, and I fished a pocket down below and it was all 15, 16, 17 inch fish. And today with the sun out the way it is, it's probably we're gonna be hard pressed to get a lot of big fish, but we'll get some big fish. But most of the fish are gonna be probably 9 to 12 inches long. There he is, little one, a little bit bigger. He's on the scud again. Another nice little rainbow. You're gonna see a lot of these little guys, and what I'm going to try to do is not even take him out of the water. I like to have, because of all these conflicting currents, you'll see that I've got a lot of loops and slack out there, so that indicator, I can see it dead drifting, and that way I know that my flies are drifting down there near the bottom. Real nice, a lot of S's out there. Come on here. That's where they were, right about in there. No. And if I see it go down, you'll notice I'll just give a little twitch and then let it continue drifting so that I get a long drift. And I try not to have a lot of back cast, maybe one back cast or even just a roll it up there, because you're not catching fish if your flies are in the air. But if you can keep those flies drifting down through that one slot over and over, you're going to have a much better chance. I've got a couple of friends when we're in Alaska that they're really good casters, but they spend a lot of time back casting. And Rick said to me one day, he says, "Jeepers, you're catching a lot more fish than I am." And I said, "Well, my flies are in the water quite a bit longer than yours because you spend so much time casting." And I said, "Your casting is great, but the fish aren't in the air." Oh, I had one. Darn it. Missed him.
It's the dead of winter in Montana, but the lower Madison River is alive with rainbows and browns that are always fun to catch, even if they don't always stay on the hook.
That's a fish.
Oh, that's a nice fish. Oh, God, that was a big one.
Yeah.
That was a big one.
Oh. I didn't set it good enough.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I saw it was a rainbow. I could see
the side. That was a nice fish.
Sure.
There you go. All right. That's a good one. All right. Oh, that is a nice one, Hugh. All right. I guess we saved the last place for you for last. Okay. Lift that rod tip up if you can. Point him up toward me. A little guy, but he's all right. Oh, he's on the scud.
All right. Well, one of the reasons that I love Montana is that there's so much good water close at hand. I moved here in 1983 down from 40 years of wandering all over the country as a Baptist minister. But when I got here, I kind of got involved with some good fishing friends and the Magic City Fly Fishers. And for 10 years, I was program chairman. And so that we did programs 10 months out of the year. So I did 100 programs. And when I reached my centennial and almost 80 years old, I decided it was time to turn the reins over. So another guy's doing real well with it. So we've got a good club.
I'm going to go around, get out sort of in front of you.
Fly fishing clubs exist all over the country, but the Magic City Fly Fishers in Billings, Montana is recognized as one of the best and as a model for how fishing organizations can enhance their sport and develop interest in future generations of anglers. We're in Billings, Montana at the Magic City Fly Fishers Expo, which is the place to be if you want to see the latest in fly tying expertise and fly fishing paraphernalia. Besides looking at all the booths, the thing to do is to buy a raffle ticket for the new drift boat and then sit in on some of the many seminars offered by experts in the industry. But most importantly, this is the place to bring the kids, as the entire event is geared towards the support of educational programs in the area, and funds from the silent auction go towards supporting such programs. Many of the club's members volunteer to be instructors, but besides casting instruction, today the kids can learn the basics of fly tying. Educational programs like this is one reason why the Magic City Fly Fishers was named the number one fly fishing club in America by the Federation of Fly Fishers.
This is the fifth annual fly fishing event that the Magic City Fly Fishers put on for the year. Last year, the Federation of Fly Fishers named us the Fly Club of the Year. So this is the largest fly fishing event in the county for the whole year. The funds for the banquet, the expo, and so forth go to educate kids in fly tying, fly fishing, a little bit of conservation. But basically, this is for kids. One of the reasons why we won this award is every year we teach over 300 kids in 11 different schools in Yellowstone County how to tie flies. And we have a cadre of about 12 to 15 members that do this. We also put on a scholarship at one of the local colleges here. And this year we started another one called the Trout University for about 15 kids. So that'll go for about 2 months. But basically the reason why we won this award was for all the things we do for kids.
If you'd like more information about the Magic City Fly Fishers, then visit them online at mcffonline.org. And if you'd like a guided trip on some of the best trout fishing waters in the world, then contact Peter Bakun at Gallatin River Guides. Go to montanaflyfishing.com or call 406-995-2290. Another example of how the value of fishing is being passed on to future generations took place not long ago near Sacramento, California, as P-Line sponsored a very successful kids' fishing day. Up next, we're going fishing with Cub Scout Pack number 222.
Hey everybody, I hope you're enjoying this week's classic episode of Angler West, where we've done some fly fishing in Montana. Now, before we go, we're going to join up with a bunch of great kids down in California at Elk Grove in a little pond where P-Line is one of the sponsors of an event, a Boy Scout fishing event, where there's a bunch of kids that are going to catch their first fish. Now, I get people coming in the shop all the time, you know, parents, grandparents, whatever, they're going to take a kid fishing, and they're like, oh, help, you know, what do I do? They don't have any idea what to do, what they need. So I always kind of get them started with just the old bobber and worm, because that works. So bobbers, you know, I'm talking about the red and white bobber here, the classic bobber. We have them in five different sizes, and they're like, these are $1.79. Besides the bobbers, you need a hook. So we've got these Poochie bait holder hooks. Bait holder hooks just means they have little barbs on them that are gonna help hold the worm on or whatever bait you're using. So a pack of these, 99 cents. And then of course you need a rod and a reel. You don't need anything fancy and expensive. And if you're gonna put line on a reel, you definitely don't need to spend $15, $20 to spool up your reel. The C21 from P-Line, $4.99 here at the shop. This is good line, and $4.99 for 300 yards, you can spool up two, you know, smaller size reels with this, and it's good stuff. So to rig up just your basic red and white bobber, all you do is you have your line with your hook on it here, and this would go to the rod. But let's say I want to put my bobber on about a foot and a half or 2 feet above the hook. So we're just going to take your line and going to push on the button right here. So this, when you push on that button, there's a wire, kind of a half loop that pops up right there. And we're just going to catch it. And then we're hanging that just like that. Okay, so then the end that's going to be attached to your rod, we're just going to loop that around, and we're going to attach it to the top. Now the only trick here is you have to put your thumb down on the bottom where that bottom wire is, and just catch this with your fingernail, lift, and that's going to lift up that wire. So I'm holding that down, and I just caught it just like that. So now I've got this slack to get rid of. Well, just push that down a little bit so you don't stretch your, you know, scratch up your line. And there you go. Now, let's head down to California and do a little pond fishing.
Today, we're at a very nice little private pond near Sacramento, California, where a group of local Cub Scouts will learn the basics of fishing. This event was made possible with the help of P-Line and Don Newman, Vice President of Sales and Marketing for P-Line.
Can we start fishing over there?
You can.
I know where the big bluegill spot is.
Where's the big bluegill spot?
Over there.
And you're not keeping that a secret?
Yeah.
All right, so somebody can take this one, and you know how to cast it, Travis?
Yep.
Okay.
Whoa.
You want to rig that one up next? Okay. Hi, my name's Don Newman with P-Line. Normally, as anglers, we're always looking for that next challenge, incorporating downriggers and electronics into our kokanee fishing, going to extreme locations like Costa Rica or Alaska to try and catch a big salmon or a sailfish. Today, we're simplifying it. Today, we're here with Troop 222, Cub Scout Troop 222, trying to get them their fishing badges. Some of the things they've got to learn today is they've got to cast the rod on their own. They've got to be able to tie their own rigs up. They've got to be able to identify the species they're catching. So it should be a fun day today. Looking forward to it.
I'm not touching it.
Okay, here, let me grab it.
My second one.
Let's see what we got here, bud.
Is that in the front?
Look at that guy.
Yeah, that's big. That's a
triple. Matthew, back up. Matthew, two steps back.
It's all the muck.
Look at that guy.
Huge.
Wow, he is huge.
Oh, that's a good one. Watch out, he's very spiny.
Are you guys going to eat him?
This pond was built in 1988 with the home up behind it. We stocked it with channel cats and largemouth bass. I feed them 3 to 4 times a day, a game fish chow, or not a day, a week. And we have catfish that'll go up to about 12 pounds. Our bass will go up to about 7 pounds, and then we have all kinds of bluegill and sunfish that'll go up to 1.5 pounds. The sunfish and the bluegill came from the canal, Rancho Seco Canal. We didn't plant those. They just came by nature. So we're pretty proud of the stock that we have here, and it's a lot of fun for the kids.
Bring them over here, baby.
Put them out your mom's lap.
I don't know if I want them in my lap, but here you go. Good job. Okay.
I don't want to touch that because you said it.
Yeah, no, just the bottom.
Hi, my name is Stacy White, and I am the den leader of Den 16, a group of 7 and 8 year old boys in second grade. We are part of PAC 222 in the Pacific Skyline Council. And in Cub Scouts, the boys have a lot of really great opportunities to earn different awards. One of those awards is called Belt Loops, where the boys accomplish certain achievements and they earn belt loops and can wear them proudly on their belt. So today, the boys are out here earning their fishing belt loop. And to earn a fishing belt loop, the kids have to meet 3 objectives. One is learning about the rules and regulations of their local fishing location. The second is learning to rig their rod, so put on their own hooks and their bait. And then the third is fishing. So today the boys have rigged their rods. Previously, Don had taught them all the rules and regulations, so we're having just lots of fun fishing and identifying all the fish that we're pulling out of the lake.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.